let's look at the adverse effects of aspirin. Main thing you have to remember is ulcers. They are going to disturb the homeostasis in the stomach, correct? So you will have ulcer. So you will have nausea, vomiting because of the CTZ, right? The chemotriceptor trigger zone is stimulated, and you will have nausea, vomiting, dyspepsia, that is indigestion. You can have indigestion. Then you will have epigastric pain, acute gastritis, ulceration. Even you can have GI bleeding. So, but main thing you have to remember is ulcers. So, ulcerogenic effect is the major drawback of NSAIDs. So, how can you prevent them? Tell them to take an aspirin after food, and tell them that, or you can give aspirin with antacid buffered, or you can also combine NSAIDs with proton pump inhibitors, H2 histamine blockers, and misoprostol. You can also call it as misoprostol. This is going to prevent the ulcer, but it can cause abortion. Okay, it is actually combined many times with the abortion drugs. So the better thing is, you know, look for instead of non-selective, which is like aspirin, give a selective COX-2 inhibitor. So this is what you want, right? COX-2 is the pathological one. So always suggest a COX-2 inhibitor. Like you have preferential COX-2 inhibitors like diclofenac, etc. Then you have selective, highly selective COX-2 inhibitor like etoricosin. Okay. Let's look at the next adverse effect, hypersensitivity. This is a very common side effect. See, it causes bronchospasm, and it can cause anaphylactoid reaction, rashes, rhinitis, etc. So basically, what is this urticaria? This is nothing but hives. So this is how it looks. Okay. So let us see why this is happening. Bronchospasm. So aspirin induces asthma. This is something you have to focus on. Aspirin induces asthma because of bronchospasm due to increased production of leukotrienes. Now, do you know that COX is inhibited, right? So what happens? LOX comes into action. When LOX comes into action, lipoxygenase comes into action, and leukotrienes are made. Leukotrienes will induce bronchospasm. Incidence of hypersensitivity is high in patients with asthma, nasal polyp, recurrent rhinitis, and urticaria. Therefore, aspirin should be avoided in such patients. So, if they have asthma, don't give aspirin. So, now let us look at this next adverse effect. In people with G6PD deficiency, if you give aspirin, it may cause hemolytic anemia. How? Because glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase is required for HMP shunt pathway. Correct? So, this is an alternate pathway to glycolysis. It's an alternate pathway to glycolysis. So, now what happens? This pathway was giving NADPH, right? NADPH was being produced. Now, NADPH cannot be produced. If NADPH cannot be produced, RBC membrane will not be able to maintain its integrity, and hence there will be hemolytic anemia. Right? So, this is something unique. If the person has a deficiency of G6PD, then only you should not give aspirin. Okay? Coming to Ray syndrome, see, aspirin should not be given to children under 12 years, they say. Because there is something unknown here. This Ray syndrome is actually encephalopathy. In children who are affected with viral disease or something, there can be hepatic damage. Okay? But even otherwise, even if they are not infected with virus, you should not give aspirin to children, because this Rice syndrome is an encephalopathy, like I told you. Some of it is unknown part. So, don't give. As to why it causes this encephalopathy, it's a very serious condition. So, salicylates are contraindicated in children. Actually, you can just take it as salicylates are contraindicated with children itself, because once they have stopped aspirin in children, Ray syndrome has drastically come down. Okay. Now, let us look at pregnancy here. Definitely, it inhibits prostaglandin synthesis. This you will write in every line maybe. Now, as this inhibiting prostaglandin synthesis, you know what prostaglandin does? It induces abortion, right? So, if you are inhibiting prostaglandin, it will delay the labor. When it delays the labor, it results in postpartum hemorrhage to be excess. Okay. And See, this is something you need to understand. If there is a ductus arteriosus which is open, right, it is good if it is open. For congenital heart disease, if the neonate has a congenital heart disease, then ductus arteriosus, if it is open, it is good. It's not for all neonates. So what happens if you give prostaglandins? The ductus arteriosus will remain patent for this neonate who has a congenital heart disease, so that till surgery it can easily survive. Now what happens if you give aspirin to such a person who has a congenital heart disease? Then it will lead to the inhibition of prostaglandin synthesis, and hence the ductus arteriosus will close, which is not a good thing. Understand? So don't give aspirin to neonate with congenital heart disease. Fine. Moving on to the last two adverse effects that you need to know for aspirin. Both of these are due to chronic uses of high doses, prolonged use of salicylates, only such things. Okay. Analgesic nephropathy. See, there is renal failure. Okay. Renal failure is reversible, which is good. Okay. Renal failure, which is reversible. Okay. Very rarely you can have irreversible renal damage. This is nephropathy. What is this? Nephropathy. Now let us look at the prolonged use. If you use it for a prolonged time, then what happens? There will be bleeding, okay, because it will continue to interfere with the action of vitamin K, and hence there is a decrease in the synthesis of clotting factors. So blood won't clot, there will be a lot of bleeding. You can treat it by administration of vitamin K again, so it's a good thing, right? Administration of vitamin K, great. So let us summarize all the adverse effects, please. Ulcers, don't forget ulcers, and how you can minimize this also is given here. Hypersensitivity, bronchospasm can happen because of leukotrienes. Coming to G6PD, you have the glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. If the person has, don't give aspirin because it can lead to hemolytic anemia. Then coming to Reye syndrome, don't give aspirin to children. Pregnancy, it will delay the labor and cause more hemorrhage, so better not give it to pregnant women who are at least in their third trimester. Then if it is a neonate which has a congenital heart disease, don't give aspirin. Why? Because it will cause premature closure of ductus arteriosus. Coming to analgesic nephropathy, there can be renal failure which is reversible, but if in very rare cases there can be irreversible renal damage. Prolonged use, what will happen? There could be bleeding because of interference to the action of vitamin K, and there is a decrease in clotting factors. How can you treat this? Just give vitamin K. Fine. In adverse effects, you can also add salicylism. Okay, that is salicylate poisoning. And what is the treatment? Okay, so basically what are the symptoms? Headache, vertigo, confusion, tinnitus, nausea, vomiting. Treatment is basically, there is no specific treatment. You hospitalize the person, gastric lavage, and you give activated charcoal. Then you maintain fluid and electrolyte balance. You correct the acid-base disturbances. Intravenous sodium bicarbonate can be given to treat the metabolic acidosis. You can also cool the person externally, hemodialysis in severe cases, and blood transfusion, vitamin K, if there is bleeding. Okay, this is severe cases only. Okay.
As we have seen in the pharmacological actions, let us look at some of these which are also adverse effects. Okay. Acid-base electrolyte balance. So basically in therapeutic doses, it will increase respiratory rate, so there will be respiratory alkalosis. This can be compensated by excretion of bicarbonate. But if you are giving toxic dose of aspirin, then the respiratory center gets depressed and there can be toxicity, respiratory acidosis. This is uncompensated. This cannot be compensated. Now, the other pharmacological actions we saw, prolonged use will cause sodium and water retention, so it will increase blood pressure.
So you should not give it for congestive cardiac failure patients. Then coming to urate in therapeutic doses, the plasma urate level will increase because the urate secretion into renal tubules will be inhibited. Now coming to high dose, in high dose, the uric acid reabsorption from the urine will reduce. So what will happen? There will be a excretion of uric acid, which is good. So this is called as a uricosuric effect. In low doses, it does something. In high doses, it does exactly the opposite. Okay. So these also you can add to the adverse effects.